rolling. It's running right now. There it is. This is for you, Jim. So these guys are here today to take this guy away. He's going on Boomer. Boomer's going on him. And these guys are Intermountain-Innovations. This is what they do. You guys are in Canby, right?
Yep.
Who you are?
Who I am?
Yeah.
My name's Adam.
And you do what?
Fabricate and manufacture.
Okay, and you're gonna turn this guy into an awesome rig, huh?
Yep.
Yeah, cool.
We're gonna drive this one off first. He's helping.
And he belongs to that company, is it? Get on up there. Mm-hmm.
hit the brake and I hit the gas.
You guys bring a battery?
Yeah.
We'll hook a winch cable up to it. At least
how the hell am I going to get out?
It's a hazard.
Jump, baby. Just pretend like you're drunk and just fall out on your lips.
You guys are funny.
Are we centered on the trailer?
Yeah, pretty damn close. Yeah, it's an inch or so, maybe. We got it pretty close. As far as wheelbase, we're way up ahead of the game. We got a lot, most of the weight on the...
Well, Frankie, you're not going to be a Ford anymore after today.
Intermountain Innovations. And that's Adam over there.
Yep. Brought me a bunch of Hot Rod magazines showing me some of his good fabrication. He's built some cars that have been in SEMA, in a lot of magazines. That's Scott right there.
Tell him again.
I'm sorry, I don't think I was introduced.
No, this is Tim.
Tim?
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm Rick.
Nice to meet
you. I've seen you.
Yeah, I met you yesterday, just briefly at the shop.
You met Aaron.
Aaron's a third wing.
So anyways, what these guys are doing is they're taking over there, my baby, and they're taking the air, which has 6,000 miles on it, and way too much money dumped into the suspension and drivetrain. And they're going to marry him. And Adam's going to take the lead on the fabrication on that. He's extending the cab on it. Going to put me some little suicide doors on the back. And then they're getting a very rare 55 GMC snub-nose truck that they're going to do kind of the same thing to, except I'm going to give them some really rare original cameo bedsides. And we're going to draw both of the trucks up. So we'll be back with pictures of the preliminary drawings on it. But today's a good day. These two car trucks are going bye-bye. One really nice truck.
Let's go see Boomer. So this is Boomer. Rick's already started on him. Customized his bed. Boomer. Boomer's gonna get a new life. This is Boomer. And then the other truck he was talking about, the snub nose. Which incidentally was a truck that I fell in love with. We found this truck in Dallas, Oregon. I wanted to turn him into a Tonka truck. I call him Jethro because he's kind of goobery looking. But these guys are going to take this truck and they are going to turn it into a drag racer. He's going to be really cool, so this is a good thing. Well, maybe I should turn the camera off. Got you a convoy going on. This is it.
Sorry to see that. Always wear your safety gear. I got my goggles.
Wow. Really? Yeah, you can't. No wonder that sunroof didn't. There went. That's amazing.
That is amazing. Well, I can see my innards now.
Yeah.
Got a broom?
Yeah.
Scott and my buddy Adam, Intermountain-Innovations, master fabricators, car builders. This is my 2007 F-250 King Ranch that we're getting ready to put on that over there. Anyway, so I spent a day down here the other day kind of trimming it down so Adam can start doing his measurements. He's the fabricator, master fabricator. This is a genius. And they want to make sure this thing still runs because they do not allow vehicles to be parked in their shop that don't run.
Does it run?
Yeah. What, I got to prove it?
Yeah, are you sure that thing runs?
Okay.
You need goggles and a hard hat?
Probably.
Thank you.
quite the wheel hop going on.
I know.
My phone ran out of memory.
Good thing you got those ladder bars in there. You probably twisted up the rear.
No weight on the butt.
I know, that's what I was wondering. This is one of Adam's trucks.
Hop away.
Did some custom fabricating on this dash.
We'll see you later.
Bye-bye. This is kind of cool. Gauge setup. This one in the ashtray. Right there.
Get that front piece you did on that.
Yeah, I did. This is a custom fab right here. Got a boomer, so that torn up old Ford we just saw, it's gonna have this guy on top of it. This is boomer. Federal Diesel is going to become. There's Jeff Wood. And he's also.
Truck rescue. We're going to rescue one of my own trucks today. Huh, Jamie?
Yeah.
Huh, Jamie?
Yes.
Huh, Jamie?
Yeah.
Which truck are we going to rescue?
We're going to rescue Boomer.
Yep. We were going to use Boomer to, we're going to use his body parts on my current build, but I got to thinking about it, and I've had Boomer a long time, haven't I?
Boomer's awesome.
Which truck's my favorite truck of all my trucks?
Boom, 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 Boomer.
Yep. So we're going to get Boomer because I decided that since we just, what?
Those were little quails.
Sorry.
I decided that since all we're doing is taking a bunch of parts off Boomer to build another truck that already has a complete drivetrain, we'll just take the parts from out at the truck ranch and bring Boomer home. What do you think about that?
Oh, we get to see Jethro, too.
Yep. Jethro's right around the corner up here. He's sitting next to Boomer. Boomer,
Mr.
Jethro,
Goober.
And that's the shop truck that we helped them build by supplying parts from Classic Truck Rescue.
What are you doing?
Taking Boomer home. Well, first, we're going to take the bed off him. Then we're taking him home.
Oh, Boomer, you get to come home.
Actually, now his name's Old Boomer. Because that truck that we're going to build in there with Scott and Adam is going to be called Boomer. But instead of using the parts off Old Boomer, we're just going to bring them all new parts from the truck ranch so they can do what they got to do.
Oh, Boomer, aren't you excited? You get to keep yourself as one big guy.
Well, once we get the bed pulled off and into the shop, I'll show you some of the special features this truck has that made me rethink parting him out and decide to keep him home.
Just wait till we pull into the yard. All the other guys would be all, hey, it's Boomer, he's back, yay!
That's Scott on the forklift and Adam's hooking Boomer up. Coming home.
Glad he decided to keep Boomer the way he is. He absolutely loves that truck. He is pretty amazing. Some junk in the trunk.
Right, just go on back
slow. Is a custom extra long, extra wide step side bed for a 55 to 59 Chevy or GMC truck. In this case, GMC, because it has a extra wide custom GMC tailgate on it. I built that bed. It's not the best fabrication in the world, but Adam's gonna clean it up. Adam and Scott make it look real nice and put it on that big truck back there. Yes, that bed is longer and wider than an original bed.
Let's pull it back so that... That would be approximately where the wheels would go there. So see,
We're just doing a...
Yeah, it'll just be about a foot, foot and a half, 2 feet.
Yeah, it's not a crew cab, it's a super cab.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Scott McFarland with Intermountain Innovations Incorporated. I've got a history of machine shop and metal fab. It goes way back. We do very, very broad spectrum of work here at Intermountain. We're in our second year right now after incorporating with Adam and his brother Aaron. And we look for fun projects to do. And kind of was excited when Rick came into the picture because he brings a different different spectrum to the view on people saving nostalgic vehicles. He doesn't like to scrap anything. He'll keep the smallest of panels and try and put them to use. And it's going to be fun to work on the Boomer project with him and make this thing come to life.
My name's Adam Bainey. I started on playing with cars when I was a typical little boy, and I never got out of it. Went to WowTech 2004, and I spent a year there. And right out of school, I got hired on at a hot rod shop, local hot rod shop, and I was there for the last decade. And I love cars, but I was looking for something different. And Scott and I decided we wanted to embark on something new, and it still involved both of our talents with machining and fabrication, and this is where we are now.
Yeah, we don't generally seek out to do cars full builds. It's not really what we're after for the most part of our business. We're a steel fabrication shop and a job shop that does our best to keep volumes coming through to pay the bills, but projects like this one kind of spice things up a little bit and allow us to use our imagination, and Adam to continue using his skills for doing what he does with cars. And, yeah, we're just looking forward to getting started on it. It's been sitting here a while, and we're kind of anxious to get going on it and work on it through the winter, and we'll hope you guys get to follow along and see how it comes out.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty amazing. How ironic, too, that you have two classic old trucks that are Chevy GMC, right?
Two 1958 Chevy 3100 Apaches. One is a step side that I've had, I bought from my dad before I was in eighth grade, and I still have it. And I have entirely too much money in it, and it's still in pieces.
And what a cool mix that you and Rick met each other and can help each other out. That's awesome.
And then we also, through this whole process of getting involved with Rick, I've got a 70 Chevy that I'm hoping to get done someday, that we've acquired from Rick, a 1955 snub nose, which is kind of a rare truck. It's a GMC, and that is going to be a project after this one is done. It'll be our own project, and we're going to do a pretty extensive hot rod feature on that truck. I'll keep everything kind of hush-hush for now. You'll get to follow along with that project as well and see the outcome of that, but it's going to be a pretty cool rig.
Yeah, I can't wait. That's the only reason why I let that guy go. I loved
it. It'll be a neat chop truck when it's done.
It's going to be pretty awesome. Okay, thanks, guys. Hey, where are you hiding at?
In the office.
Look, he just woke up. I just took off the reading glasses and been staring at a computer.
This is your truck too, right? The 58?
Yep, this is a 1958. It's my second one. I got it from my dad this June or July, and I put in a couple of months of work in it, and it's running and driving.
Sounds pretty good too, I might add.
Yeah, not too shabby for a little 283. I don't know if it's the original 283. It has the original mounts in it, so it may be, it may not be. I don't know a whole lot about the truck, but I swapped beds on it, and I plan on shooting in primer, getting a business logo on it, changing the wheels, and driving it for
awesome.
A while.
Awesome. He's got, this is my favorite hood. I love those big humps.
The plan for this truck eventually, so I'm going to build a chassis for it. It'll sit pretty low, and it'll have most likely a Cummins 4BT or 6BT diesel in it, and it should get some decent mileage. Looking for some decent mileage on a daily driver.
Cool.
It could be a good chop truck as well.
Awesome. No discrimination on truck branding around here. Duluth trading. Every time I look at him, I see something different and something more cool. Look at that.
Oh, the chain? Mm. I told you, it's
that
a monster
operates
winch.
Operates massiveness.
That's actually a transfer case down there for all of the add-on accessories that this truck has on it. It's got a hydraulic pump on it right back here. It's operated by a different PTO takeoff. And those hydraulic hoses right there.
He could be a yarder. He could be whatever he wants.
Yeah, and the frame is totally reinforced from back here behind this bulldozer winch that was factory installed in 1955 all the way up to the front bumper. And look at that stack of springs.
He's the only one in existence probably, huh?
This truck was used. It was bought by the guy I got it from. His grandpa bought it in 1955, had it sent immediately to have the frame reinforced, the front suspension beefed up, and had that bulldozer winch put on it and a hydraulic system. Then he had a utility box put on it, and it was used to go down the road. It would pick up telephone poles off a trailer that was behind it, hoist them up over its roof, and plant them in holes that it had just drilled with a drilling rig that was mounted to the front of it.
He did have one of those things that I like.
What things that you like, Jamie?
That picks up logs. You know, it looks like that.
Dangle head?
Yeah.
No. Ooh. He could, though. What you doing, Jamie?
Jamie and I are taking Boomer home.
You are?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, I think I made the right choice. If we're gonna build a truck out of parts, I've got tons of parts. There's no reason to take Boomer apart. Plus this truck, you know, in 1955 standards, what happened to this truck when it was new with the guy having the frame doubled up all the way from the front bumper to the back, bulldozer winch installed, a transmission just for the PTO to run hydraulics, that winch, and a front winch, would have been the equivalent of someone spending like $150,000 on a truck today. And you can see that it was done when it was new, because even the winch was built in 1955. If you look at this tag over here, 6 of 55. So in June of 55, this truck was built. And someone put a lot of money into it. You can see that plating goes all the way up to the front end. They even went around the leaf spring mounts and everything on it, around the rear leaf spring mount. This whole plate, or this whole frame, has a quarter inch plate steel running all the way from the front to the back. And if you look at the stack of springs on the front of it, it's definitely built up. Mm-hmm. So this would be a good truck for us to leave around here in its present configuration. Put some big poles on the back of it that we can run that cable up to a pulley. And when we get back and we're tired and want to lift a whole truck off of a trailer, we can do that with this. So we're here at Intermountain Innovations doing a little work on the Boomer project. Adam's the fabricator on this job. And so what are some of the biggest obstacles you think we're going to have to overcome with this?
I would say the core support, changing the core support, and fitting that cab to the factory firewall of the Ford.
This cab?
Yeah, the problem is this front end is kind of thick right here. So we got to relocate all of this stuff right here. And Adam's got to do a lot of fabrication to get all the mounts for, because this bumper weighs about 150, 175 pounds. So he's got to make it where all of this front end stuff bolts up to this. And he's got to integrate these fenders with the existing inner fenders, so it's a lot of work. I was up here, now here a couple of weeks ago, and took out the dash, because one of the main goal on this project is to have an old truck, classic truck styling with a modern truck technology. And Adam took notes on where all these wires go, so he knows exactly where everything goes, right? Right?
Yep.
Right now.
Yep.
Fortunately, all of these plugs and everything for the controls will only plug into one spot, so it's just a process of elimination when I go put it back together. But I'm going to finish stripping out the carpet, get everything gutted from the inside. This is the cab we're going to use. I'll strip that down. And then Adam's going to get started on the cutting and welding and grinding.
Yep. We'll brace up the cab and we'll cut the floor and the firewall out. And I could trim some of this extra stuff out and start fitting the cab to the new chassis.
Yeah, because we're going to use this floor and as much of the firewall as we can. That way the original seats will bolt in. It'll have all the six-way power electric seats.
Just want to hop up there. Can I step on there?
Yeah.
So that's what you got to deal with, all of that. Yikes.
Anyway, we literally have to start at the front on this because he not only has to get the front bumper and everything to fit in the right position, but he's got to do it in such a way that those wheel wells are centered right above the axle. And he can't even begin mounting the cab until he figures out exactly where the front end's going to go. And the location of the front end will determine where the cab sits on the floor. So we're going to get started and get some things stripped down today and get it to where Adam can move forward. Peace out. I thought that it'd be easier for Adam if he didn't have all the wiring in the way.
Oh, goodness.
When he starts chopping all the.
And you know what? One thing I learned from you?
Yeah.
Why wiring is not one of your favorite things.
Well, sometimes you got to do what you don't like.
That is a bundle.
Yeah.
It's okay, Gopher. Don't get frightened. He probably has a lot more.
He's got the same thing. Got all the carpet out. Basically, I had to remove anything that could burn because the Adam's going to be cutting and welding. But it's about as stripped as it gets. I'm hoping we don't have to remove the heater assembly. We just stopped by to check on his progress on my boomer truck, which is where we're putting an old truck body on a new truck chassis. I say we. All I did was tear everything apart. This is the guy that puts it back together. But anyways, I see a ton of difference. It might still look like it's got a long ways to go, and I'm sure it does, but I see a ton of difference between the last time I was here and where I am now.
Well, what the heck is
your eye,
what the heck is that?
This is new floor support we built for the truck, the clearance up front, so that we can pull the cab forward and get the fenders back to where axle center line lines up to the axle.
I see a ton of stuff has changed, but what did you do, Adam?
Well, we built a new core support, and that gave us the clearance we need to bring the cab forward, the fenders back, so that the axle center line in the fender well opening matches the axle itself.
And the reason you had to do that is because we've got this Mondo grill out here that sits back up in where the radiator used to be. So Adam had to move not just the radiator, but all of the stuff on the front of the truck back so that we could make that fit.
This is,
you want to use the original controls for the dash and the heating and air conditioning system. So he's incorporating all this new stuff so it has the modern technology with an old school dashboard. But he's leaving the firewall of the original truck intact and just hanging the sheet metal from it.
So what I will do is, what I'm working on right now is we're gonna get this current firewall trimmed out to where you see a sight profile of it. We'll get this kind of outlined where it needs to go to fit this cab. And you can see here, I initially kind of lined out where I'm gonna have to cut. I haven't cut it yet because I didn't want to cut more than I needed to. But this area is going to have to get cut out to accommodate for the heater on the inside of the cab so the two cabs can come together.
Keeping the original floor intact, so that's going to help this truck a lot with its rigidity and just, you know, integrity. Having the original mounts for the seats and everything, the original floors, that stuff all bolts to the frame correctly. And the, where a lot of guys screw up, and I think Adam will agree with me on this, it, when they're rebodying cars, is they will try to make the old suspension and everything work with the other body. And if you can keep as much of the original structure intact as possible and just basically hang the sheet metal from that, it winds up a lot better.
So if you come over here, you can see on the driver's side yet, I haven't cut any of it yet. What we have left is remnants from the core support, what's left off the core support in the front, and then the inner fender structure, which is all kind of a unibody setup that Ford has, that when it goes into a dealership, they remove all the bolts in the cab, including the core support bolts up front. The whole thing picks up in a unit, and they can work on the motor, work on the transmission, whatever they need to work on, and then they put it back down. Well, this is going to be still the same concept when we put the GMC body on here. We're going to still set it up to where that could be removed at a dealership if possible. Soon, you can see on this side, on the passenger side, that's all been removed already. What I'm doing is working on getting all of the A-pillar left trimmed out, so we have just a side profile of the firewall to work with the GMC body.
So this is what is left on the other side that you still need to get off, right?
Yep. So bits and pieces, there's some steel, there's some rubber and plastic I need to pull out of there, and then I can trim the rest of it out of there.
Well, that's really cool that that factory Ford stuff will be integrated, because I've seen them when they're working on them.
Yes, and the really neat part about keeping the original floor and firewall and all the electronics and everything is this can go to a dealership. Ford can pick this up off the GMC body with the Ford floor and everything, pick it up off and work on everything they need to work on, set it back in place, and everything's just how it came in.
That's awesome. What's under the protection towel?
Under the welding blanket.
Welding blanket.
We have a heater and all the other goodies. Pull
and
back
and
up in the
place
for now.
You remember where all those wires go, right?
Sure do. So everything's pulled back tight up into place for now. Once you get the cab in place, the front end in place, and we start working, I get to a point where I can start working on the inner fender areas. All the electronics and everything will be bolted back into place. It'll pretty much look original other than being on GMC inner fenders.
Awesome. Quite a project.
Or I guess it'll be early afternoon.
Yeah, it's morning.
We are.
So we got an 8-foot ladder here.
They're 9 feet, just under 108.
Boomer's gonna be 9 feet tall.
That's not fair, I'm totally jealous.
Better be careful going through fast food places.
Yeah.
The places that need the
You can't.
The clearance.
Gotta watch that clearance.
This is not right, I'm totally
jealous. I don't know, it seems like if you're driving a truck that big, they ought to just bring it up.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what, it might be kind of difficult to hang out the window to drop mail into the slot too.
Yeah.
I would have my caboose up in the air.
You've done it before. All right, so Adam's done a bunch of work over here. Come look at this.
I am really super jealous.
We're getting closer.
Take a look at where the pedals are now, as opposed to last time we saw them when they were hugging each other. Straighten out the firewall. How'd you go about straightening out that firewall, Adam?
Pulled this tank off. This is for the radiator coolant tank. The tank off. We snuck the forklift fork in here. Got it right up to where the crease is in the firewall. And after I pulled everything off the A-pillar on this side, got this plate up here so we can pull it off the plate with the chain. And we just started coming along and with the chain, pulled that part of the firewall out.
It's come out quite a bit, hasn't it?
Yes, it has.
Yeah, I like the way the pedals look a lot better.
Was it off quite a bit?
They were almost touching.
Yeah,
and you actually got that on film the last time we were down here. But how close the brake pedal is to the gas pedal.
Mm-hmm.
It's because the firewall's kinked right here where you can see that from going like that. This really took a good hit.
Yeah.
Did you get...
Yeah.
Let me see that real quick. So before the pedals were touching, but as you can see now, a clearance in between them, and that firewall's actually come in quite a bit, and this has come out. And then he trimmed it off. He's getting ready to mate the cab, the old cab, to the new firewall.
Get the cab in place, and I get the front end. I would like to get the front end kind of taken care of and get most of the way done. And the cab gets welded in place, and I'll rebrace it. We'll get the back of it cut out, and kind of figure out where we're going to stretch. But before we get too carried away with that, I'll get the back of the old cab cut off of here and get the bed in place so I know exactly how much we need to stretch it.
Gosh, it's so weird. This kind of stuff gives me goosebumps.
It's going to be neat. You'll be the only one like it in the whole world.
Just like you.
Yeah. The world can be thankful for that. I'm not over here cracking the whip on Adam because he does this in his spare time, and it is a lot of work involved with it. He's not just tacking some doors and fenders onto a different truck. He's going to make them look right and everything work right together. I'm really impressed with the work you're doing. Thank you.
I'm excited. It's going to be awesome. Can't wait.
Yeah, that's looking pretty good, huh?
What do you think, yeah?
I like it. I mean, I know it's still a long ways from being done.
It's going to be massive.
But it's going to be a one-of-a-kind truck. It's going to be pretty neat.
Totally.
And it's going to be a truck that represents the trucks that I deal in. So, good deal. What do you think, Annabella? She says, I just want to ride in it. That's all bad. Oh,
I hear something. Oh, look at it. Hey, I think that's Adam. Oh, that is Adam. Look it. There's one of our fellow boys right there. Good, how are you?
Great.
Nice of you guys to show up, get all the work's done. We finally got the place cleaned up.
Now we got time for dinner. About time. Yeah.
Did you bring anything with you?
Like a barbecue?
Good time.
Hi, Rick. What are you and Scott talking about today?
We've been talking about Boomer.
Yeah, Boomer's a project.
This project that we all kind of got involved in, and it's been a long road. It's been, you guys have been in on it for a year, but I actually bought the original Boomer 4 years ago, and I'm excited about it. I know they're excited about it.
Yeah.
Basically, these guys are helping me build what I firmly believe in and am comfortable saying is going to be the coolest truck a lot of people have ever seen in their lives. And I don't think I could have done it without them. Matter of fact, I know I couldn't have, because these guys bring technical skill, welding, weird things like plasma cutters and stuff. I work in a barn, you know? I go out and I rescue 60-year-old trucks that have been sitting out in the bushes for 30 years. I drag them home. I get them running. Sometimes I sell them. Some of them I'll never sell. But these guys are helping me build my dream truck, and they're doing a good job.
Well, and, it's with, you know, with Adam's history and skills and where he's come from before we started our corporation, he's able. able to do this because he's got the knowledge. He built high-end hot rods that were million-dollar cars.
I know, and that's how you guys sold me on the project.
I mean, it's just, he can tell you more about it.
We won't get too deep into that, but they showed me proof that they know what they're doing, and I was impressed. And basically, I turned my dream over to them because I believe that they can help me accomplish it.
Well, I'll tell you what, if there's one guy in the world that'll make something what it's supposed to be and your vision come to life, it's Adam. Because he knows how to do it. He's done it for 12 years with customers that would have never had the car they had.
Oh, I've seen his work. You guys sold me. You had me, I met these guys. They stopped by my place. And so you guys stopped by because you were interested in one of my trucks.
Well, we were driving around, what, 4 years ago?
3 or 4, yeah.
Yeah, and Adam saw all these trucks in this, under these trees, and it was like,
I wanted to find a fleet side bed back then. I was looking for a fleet side bed.
Yeah, I've helped you find a couple of them. Yeah, yeah.
Yes, you have. Yeah. And that's kind of where the relationship started, though. I mean, that's when we first met. I don't think he had the fleet side at the time.
He had some stuff that he didn't want to get rid of.
Yeah, you know? Yes, we have.
Yeah. But we wandered around out there for a couple hours. That was the first time I met.
You guys met me when I had about 15 trucks. I've got about 50 now.
And a boat.
15 trucks and a boat.
Yes.
And a year later, we found you again.
Out here.
Yep, out here.
Yeah, another friend of ours, he drove by and we didn't know you were out here. And he'd come to it because he knew that Adam was still looking for some stuff. And he said, "Have you seen all those trucks out there?" And no. So we drove out here and it's like, how do we approach this guy? Because either he's selling these things or he's
going to shoot us when he's driving the truck.
So we pulled in the driveway and I don't know if we woke you up or not, but you had a cup of coffee in your hand, so it was cool.
You didn't wake me up because if I had a cup of coffee in my hand, that means I was awake.
Yeah, and then evolved from there.
You guys were interested in one truck in particular.
And we own that truck.
Jethro, yep. You do own that truck. Well,
we're working on it.
you guys own that truck.
We got Jethro. Actually, yeah. It was Jamie's favorite truck until we took it away.
You know, she wasn't real happy about you guys being interested in that truck either, and that's why I had to go out and get another one. That's why we have Gomer now. She's okay. See, she's smiling.
Yeah, but you know what?
They told me about your rendering on that truck. I would like to see that.
That's because I spied it when I was here a couple weeks back.
Oh, in my office?
Yeah. Yeah.
But this guy wants one of my favorite trucks.
Yeah, I do. I do.
Which one are you after?
Woody.
Woody?
Yeah.
You know what?
When my business takes off, I'm going to come get it.
If you'll part with it.
Don't play your cards too. Price goes up.
You know, Woody and I have a love-hate relationship. Buying him and getting him home and renting a motel for a couple of days and hanging out in front of Napa and
on Super Bowl
him running so I could drive him off the trailer, cut the deck off him. Chain it to a railing and pull the deck off it with spark flying and get him home.
Yeah, he told us. I'll sell you the owner of the place to see if you can leave it there.
And I video sparks flying off his bed when I unloaded it so we could get him home. But really,
I'm interested. Yeah, I love
that
truck.
Beautiful. He is a good looking.
He said I could drive him.
After it's done.
He's got air brakes. You know that, right?
Yeah. I don't care. We're gonna put diesel in him.
Well,
he
needs new saddle tanks, though.
You might want some air brakes. You need diesel.
He needs new saddle tanks.
Yeah, his saddle tanks are going on my dump truck.
That's funny. I remember the dump truck, too.
Yeah.
Steve drove the... Steve rescued the truck. He did. I appreciate that.
That was fun. Made my day a couple times.
We use him every week. We used him today. We drove him to the mill and got 3 tons of feed in him. Ran like a top, didn't
he? He's my new favorite.
That's our new favorite truck.
I don't know what that noise is up front. We're trying to talk that.
Oh, we got another hot rod. It's Todd. Todd's our neighbor. He has a company in town here called BBC Steel. He's gonna come hang out with the guys. Tailgate?
Yeah, I think it is, actually.
You're so funny. It went to a good cause.
It went to a good home.
And that's what we want, right?
Classic Truck Rescue,
that's
providing
right.
Tailgates for rat rods.
Boy, you got a whole entourage here today, baby.
Yeah. Hang on, I'm gonna drop it.
Oh, that's cool.
That is very cool.
On the thing,
we'll
help you out.
Or the battery.
Down.
Oh yeah, I do like the headliner. Do you have a California black plate up there?
No.
Gee, I bet you wish you had one.
But I'm doing a 64. I got a 60 that I just bought not too long ago. That I'm working on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like your tailgate.
Yeah, thanks. It's perfect.
I handpicked that myself.
I said I have the back one.
Really? Yeah. Oh, and that?
Yeah, I just went and got that, what, 2 weeks ago?
Wow.
No, 3 weeks ago.
Old Yeller.
Sat for 30 years. I had it running the day we got home.
Mm-hmm.
And driving around here the next day.
I think he's getting kind of attached to
really?
It.
Really? Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm going to keep that one.
You let anybody in here.
I look like a surfer dude.
Hey, you called me. Yeah, I'm a surfer dude.
This guy, though. This guy, yellow guy.
That's Banana Rammer. Anyone want to know why I call him Banana Rammer?
I'll buy it.
No, I'm gonna go with
the guy that I bought this truck from. Somebody had that truck built into a show truck in the 1980s. He dumped a ton of money into the engine and drivetrain on it, but it's an original NAPCO four-wheel drive, 1958 Chevy. And these guys can tell you it will hop.
I'll tell you.
Tilt front end. A custom dump bed on it.
I think we should go look at Frankentruck's guts.
I agree.
Then what happened to it after that, though?
Oh, anyway. Yeah, we got to finish that.
Beat the devil.
So anyways, I call it Banana Rammer because the guy that I bought it from bounced it off every solid object on his property, including those big metal telephone poles. But, it hadn't run for 15 years when I got it. It runs and drives now. And I think it's worth saving.
but it runs and drives.
Yeah, that's what I said.
How's it start?
When you let out the clutch, you shut the engine off.
Hey, Rick, I mentioned, I got to see what we started with. I want to see what left our shop and ended up in your shop.
We should do that.
Yep.
Let's go look.
I gotta see.
So we've saved every single piece that's came off. Boomer's what it's going to be called when it's done. But we saved every nut and bolt and wire and connector off of that truck. And I have them back here. You want to go see?
Yep.
It's the cab maze.
So there's the wiring. There's all the little nuts and bolts. And there's everything else. Every piece of metal and plastic that we cut off of that thing. But I assure you, I held on to this for a good reason.
You're going to need some of that stuff, right?
I know, huh? But anyways, it's all here. So basically everything that's come off of the truck is here. All the wearings right there, pretty much intact. And
the last little bits of it I have still at the shop. And I may need them from time to time. So.
Yeah, and if you need something for your fabrication end of it, and you say, hey, Rick, I need this bracket or
there's
door post. Or
we have some stuff to add to this pile.
Quite a bit,
actually. Really? Because the bed's kind of full.
You might, you're going to need a little more room.
I'm confident that we're going to get this thing built, and I'll go ahead and hang on to this. So you guys pop by my place, and you like Jethro. I got to admit, when you came by the second time and had some documentation showing me the kind of work that you do, I was impressed. How did you guys come to be a company?
Go ahead and field this one.
I've been wanting a change for a little while. I wouldn't say that I was bored, but I was ready for something different. Maybe to back away from cars for a little while and ease back into it again, but on my own terms.
This is what we've got the opportunity to meet you, and it's been a really great experience.
What's sad is that kind of my generation, maybe a little ahead of me, maybe a little older, but definitely younger. It's kind of going away. All the modern cars, modern technology, and the younger kids are...
They like the sewing machines.
Yeah, they're just heading that direction, and this is almost kind of a lost art, a lost...
I think about that a lot, Adam, and what are they going to collect? Priuses? Subarus?
We were just talking about that, what car is out there right now. Adam had a 2006 GTO, and in my mind that's the only car that I can come up with in modern era, because there was very few built, that somebody 25 or 30 years down the road is going to want to get a hold of and restore.
Or a smart car.
It's just a piece of history.
Keeping history alive, really.
You know, I think the biggest thing that keeps me broke is the guy that tells me, if you don't buy it, I'm going to scrap it. Do I want to see a car smash that's not being built and hasn't been built for 30 or 40 years?
Yep.
Well, it's just like that one right there. That Nova. It's a nice car.
I sacrificed a lot to get that car.
To turn it over to somebody else.
Yeah, I got it running. It runs and drives now. And that one over there I'm going to keep, though. I brought a couple of tires and wheels down today to put on the front of Boomer down here at the shop, because Adam's got my front fenders on there. They're just kind of tacked into place and everything, but we want to get a good idea what the front of it's going to look like. What about you? You guys want to see what the front of it looks like?
Yeah, bring it.
All right.
There's a big machine in front of it.
Yeah, that's the world's biggest. Didn't he say it was the world's biggest?
World's biggest?
I think he said. Or the biggest one on the west coast. And what is it? It's a slabber?
Yeah. I get
this big logs. Machine slabs logs. And this is the frame it goes on right here.
Hi, Steve. Someone wanted to say hi.
Hi, Steve.
Hi.
How you doing?
Oh, wonderful. Trying to cure a nightmare.
We brought a little orphan Annie for you to see.
I'm all greasy.
What is this called again? A slabber?
This is a splitting mill.
A splitting mill.
A chainsaw mill.
It's got a Chrysler Slant 6 in it. But isn't it like the biggest one? How big's the bar on it?
On the west coast.
Biggest one on the west coast? Why?
Because it's got a 10-foot bar.
So it slabs some big logs.
9 foot is our max. 9 foot in diameter.
I see something behind you I really want to be looking at.
It's nasty.
I gotta go look at that. Holy cow. I like it. I like the way this is going.
It grew.
We brought down a couple wheels to put on the front of it.
Look, I'm 6 feet tall. Look how big this is.
I know, huh? I know, and that dog's 30 feet tall.
This dog is an Afghan.
It's a 60-pound dog.
She's an Afghan.
So it's not going to be that tall because it's... Well, hold up a second, though. It's sitting on the suspension, though.
It is. Yeah, it is.
It's sitting on the suspension, so it's not going to go down that far.
About another 2 or 3 inches.
Yeah, so it'll be about probably a total of about 6 inches shorter than it is right now. But it's 9 feet tall, so I'm good with that. But over here...
You can't go through any car washes.
I don't...
Not
that would work when you got done going through them. You could go through them probably.
You go to the truck car wash.
Now, see, now he's going to make me go through a car wash in that thing. And you know it's going to destroy that poor car wash. But this over here is a 1940 Cadillac limousine, chopped. They're making a hot rod out of it. These guys build some pretty cool stuff down here. That's definitely going to be one of a kind. I guess it's one of the original cars, one of about 25 that were made. But, you know, this is hot rodding, and this is what this guy wants. So that's what it's being built into. And I don't imagine it was any cream puff of a car. Although it doesn't look that bad, really. That's going to be pretty sinister looking, though. Yeah. That's what I'm down here for, though. I'm going to go unload some tires and wheels and put them on that. So I'm here at Intermountain-Innovations in Canby, where they're building my boomer truck with Adam and Scott. And Adam's done a bunch of work to it since the last time I was here. This truck is taking a while to build because it's not easy integrating an old cab like that with a modern truck. There's a lot of, it's real busy up under the hood of the 2007 King Ranch. There's a lot of electrical, there's a lot of other systems that need to be accounted for that weren't on the earlier truck. So he's got to incorporate, build new mounts, make provisions for all of the stuff that was on the newer truck and made it up to the older truck. It is going to be huge though, and it is going to have all of the modern conveniences. Adam, can you just go over, an overview? We've got video of everything pretty much that's been done, but what happened is I brought this truck over here. I cut the roof off of it, took the doors off of it, gutted the interior, pulled the wiring out, and then Adam took over. He's doing all the fabrication work on this truck. He's been working on it for a long time. In his spare time, he does have a job and a life too. So definitely not rushing him, especially when you see the quality of the work that he's doing. Just leave him alone, let him do his thing. Anyway, go ahead, Adam.
Like Rick said, he cut the roof off, took the doors off, had everything pretty much stripped down, and then I just took the cab and started cutting the firewall out, trimming slowly, piece by piece, a little section by section, and staying with the firewall on the Ford itself until I could get the Chevy cab to slide forward past the cab or the firewall in the Ford.
And you also had to do some repair work to the firewall too, where it was bent.
In the accident, it had taken this part of this firewall and smashed it to where the brake pedal was almost into the gas pedal. So we did a little, I guess you'd call it redneck engineering, and used a forklift and a come along and pull it back into place, chain and a come along, and straighten it back out. And we were able to keep going, get the cab moved farther forward, basically enough to where I could get axle center line figured out over the front end for the fenders, and I was able to set the cab and start piecing everything back in. The most difficult part of the firewall, I would say, was probably the passenger side. Tying in the four.
Let's go over and look at that. Yeah, I remember that was a difficult. You had a lot of obstacles to overcome on that.
And now that the inner fender's all done, you can't really see it, but there's a large heater box from the Ford that's both on the inside and the outside of the firewall.
And you had to put a lot of thought into that too, huh?
Yeah, I had to get a little creative. So there's actually a piece of tubing up here on top inside the firewall that has a vent on the other side and a vent in the bottom of here, so it can still use the factory heater from the Ford and pull fresh air from the course or the cowl from the pickup, as well as the bottom of these gutters that still make the cowl functional.
Yeah.
I think since you were here last, or one of the last times you were here anyway, I was able to get the hood on, get them adjusted, the hinges adjusted, and it opens and closes pretty close right now. The driver fender has a little work to do, so it's not completely set in place, but the passenger fender and everything is more or less done, and it's pretty close to being in place. So
you got a lot of work into this core support too, don't you?
I do. I have a lot of time into there. These filler panels took a little bit of time, a little creativity to figure these out, get the AC lines plumbed back into place.
Yeah, everything's a tight fit up here because there's a very big bumper that goes on this truck with some huge bumper bullets, and it's got a very busy grill. So he had to make provisions for all of the new trucks, cooling systems and things like that, and still be able to put that grill on there.
Very, very tight fit, but we were able to keep the AC condenser, the intercooler, and the radiator up front.
That was good too, because I remember at one time we were talking about having to relocate a bunch of that stuff.
Most likely either the intercooler or the radiator, and I definitely didn't want to move the radiator just because Ford had an engineer to be where it was, and I'd rather leave it cooling wise. But the intercooler, of course, is best up front in direct air, cold air as well. So the only thing that's left in the front here, I need to finish the driver, inner fender, along with the setting and finishing, fitting all the electrical components on this side, power steering, reservoir as well. This is white guy here. And then I can set the hood and the grill. There may be a little bit of trimming on part of the grill to get it to fit up here just because of how
on the back side of it?
Yeah.
That's fine. I'm good with that.
The hood hinge is very, very close as well, but need to be able to get a little creative there and make sure we've got clearances that we need.
This has been a long project, but the level of work that Adam's doing on this, the deal that we originally made for him to build this truck, no way compensates him for the hours that he already has into this project. And the reason that I'm just giving him kind of free rein with it and going with it is because, like I said, the level of work that he's doing is exceptional. And I know that he is enjoying this project because he gets to do it the way that he wants to do it. He's not being micromanaged. There's no way I could afford to have the work, even the work that he's done already, done on it. And I do appreciate it, Adam. And I know this is just about the passion of the project for you, but we'll see what we can do about compensating you a little bit. There may be a bonus at the end of the road for you. All right, so for Classic Truck Rescue, Boomer update. A lot of guys been asking about this truck. These are the guys that are making it happen. Scott and Adam, Intermountain Innovations. Thank you guys, appreciate it. We're gonna let you get back to work, quit bothering you.
Okay, the next step will be, I do need to continue and finish the inner fender on this side, and then that front end, with the bumper and the grill. But the next plan is to go ahead and fit the box.
So you can figure out how much you need to stretch the cab. Yeah. Yeah, this is gonna be, the cab's gonna be stretched on this. We're gonna have, what, one door or two doors?
Two doors.
Two doors on the, two doors on the back.
I think that was your preference, yeah. Was two.
Yeah, yeah, but beggars can't be choosers.
I know we originally talked about suicide doors, but I think
it's your call.
I'll cut into there and see, but if I can make the standard hinges in the front part of the
I think it'd be more cab more stable.
And like I showed you on the other cab, you know, you have those two doors come out. They don't, neither one of them open big enough to give you enough access between them.
Yeah. All right, well, thanks for the update. Thanks for your time. We'll get out of your face. We're going to get a 58 Chevy short bed fleet side right now. Adam's got
one. Give me
that look. Adam's got one outside. Don't give me that look.
Have you heard that one? Yeah, running good.
Oh, this one over here? Let's go look at the shop truck.
Yeah, yeah. It runs.
Can you fire it up for us? This is Adam's 58 Chevy shop truck that he built for himself. One piece at a time, the hard way. I watched it all come together. Pretty cool. He just put a new motor in it. We like that. I don't think that thing's even broke in yet. A little truck that packs a big punch.
Work in progress.
Did you figure out what you're gonna do with Jethro over there?
Not yet.
Still up in the air on that, huh?
Yeah, kind of back burner for a while.
You got time to think about that one.
A lot of time to think about it.
Yeah. Well, thanks for sharing the shop truck with us.
Yeah, no problem.
We're gonna get out of your face and let you get back to work. See you next time, Boomer. Seen him in 20 years. Love you, Dave.
Love you too, bro.
That's his hot rod right there. We're gonna go for a putt in it. Good seeing you. This is my other brother, Don. His girl, Katie. Warm it up.
Okay.
Sounds nice, huh?
Is it possible to drive this without smiling?
No, it's not. You got people honking at you, running out in front of you. They damn near get ran over.
Yeah.
They almost get run over running in front of you. Because they're so damn happy to see this thing come barreling down the road.
Very tastefully done, Dave.
Yeah,
I like it. I love the color. Oh, that's my favorite color.
Ooh. I bought it with 350 miles on it. Yeah, 8,000 miles.